listening to Ka-Pow, the pop culture podcast. Comics, television, movies, and more. If it impacts fan culture, we have something to say about it. And now, your hosts, Jordan, Cliff, and Seth.
Merry Christmas, everybody. Ka-Pow, the Pop Culture Podcast, is back with you in this festive holiday season. My name is Jordan Lowe.
Cliff Barnes.
I'm Seth.
We got a guest. He's not even a guest, guys. Yeah. He's just here.
I snuck in.
We're happy to have him.
I snuck in.
EOJ is back. Mr. Jesse Starcher.
What's up, guys? My goodness. Seth.
It's great for an audio show.
Yeah,
he has props. I bought him props.
Picked up some bad habits this past week.
That's right.
Good. Smoking some candy cigarettes.
Dude, you coming out with a candy cigarette at the gas station was the best thing ever. All right? Because I was just waiting for somebody to come running out of the booth. No! What are you doing?
Hitting the emergency stop button.
Yeah.
That's great.
We took a road trip, everybody. Jesse came along. The four of us headed to Columbus recently. This year's GalaxyCon, big comic con up there at the Greater Columbus Convention Center.
I'm still wearing my lanyard.
Nice. What's that get you into?
Great for an audio podcast.
GalaxyCon.
Second year. Mm-hmm. I think it's only the second year it's been in Columbus, I think.
Wow. As far as we know.
Yeah.
Let's say that.
Yeah, we'll agree to that. 100%.
I was supposed to go the first time you guys went.
Yeah.
And I got a little scared, a little frightened with some of the stuff that was going around on health-wise here at the house, so I did not participate. This time, though, I drank my orange juice.
We don't care anymore.
No, no, we don't.
I didn't see a lot of masks in that building.
No.
There wasn't at all.
I'm kind of surprised the more celebrities aren't masked up.
They gave up. They don't care.
Yeah. Yeah, last year.
When you're rich, you can just buy yourself.
Last year when we went,
blood
some
transfusions.
Of them had a plastic plexiglass barrier in between them and us. And
the people.
Oh, yeah. I don't even remember that.
Yeah, some of them. Not all of them, but some of them did last year.
I missed my bubble.
Yeah, the comic creators don't care. I went to many cons this past year, and I maybe saw one of them wear a mask. Like, they're just like, what? Whatever.
They're the ones meeting and shaking. Yeah.
A lot of people. Granted, they have their own little open area, you know, 10 by 10 or whatever. And, you know, they're not walking in the crowd, but I think they're just like, whatever. Mm-hmm. They probably get it so often.
Exactly.
They're,
like,
they're the spreaders.
They're super spreaders.
Their lives are so terrible as it is. They don't care. Nothing more can make it worse.
We hear it asylum.
So we took off bright and early Sunday morning. Got there in good time, drove the speed limit. We're very safe the entire way up.
Yes.
Got there right when it opened. Not any crazy lines to get through. No security whatsoever. We could have literally...
Mm-hmm. No.
Oh, you could have had anything in that poster. That poster holder thing, man. You could...
True.
Oh, yes.
Could have had a Yogi Bear poster in there and... They'd have never known. Mr. Yep. Phillips, Mr. Phillips would have never known.
So this show is a good mix. Lots of big name celebrities, lots of comic creators, lots of vendors.
So lots of people.
Lots of people.
Yeah.
Again, Sunday's a little easier to navigate. We think we haven't gone on a Saturday, but we've heard reports from people that Saturday is tough.
That's
to even
crazy,
get through.
And I heard people saying while we were there, like, it's not as bad as it was. You know, it's still busy, and everybody's for the most part stayed till Sunday. You know, they know mm-hmm. that to get the Sunday crowd, families and such. Usually, it's like a discounted rate for families on Sunday. But a lot of creators stayed. Usually, I mean, I feel like in the past, a lot of people duck out on Sunday, you know. And a couple people did leave early.
Yeah.
But I didn't have any problem getting anybody I wanted to get.
I walked through there at the end looking for one more signature. And I just skated through the celebrities one more time. And they were almost all gone by, like, you know, it was 4 mm-hmm. o'clock. Like, they were pulling the banners down. Yeah. But, like, I saw Giancarlo Esposito was still there. Michael Rooker was still there. And the guy who voices Vegeta on Dragon Ball Z still had like 40 people in his line. Like,
wow.
His line was long, though. I think he was the most popular person in that room. So
wow.
That's crazy. We're like 10 feet from Sean Gunn just a day before it's announced he's Max Lord.
Right.
Right.
Like, that's crazy.
Yeah.
Or like Michael Rooker. I'm like, he's right there. I could reach him if I reach out. And like, the next day on Instagram, he's at dinner with James Gunn. I'm like, it's crazy.
Yeah.
It's pretty neat.
It was pretty cool. It was pretty cool. Yeah.
I didn't go get any of their autographs or anything, but it's neat to see him.
Yeah. I didn't either. I had my, you guys know, I had my one little moment I wanted with Tate Donovan, which was pretty cool.
I provoked that. I feel I take full credit for
that. Yeah. Like, Cliff, we were walking.
It's right there. Nobody's over there. Nobody cares about that.
Yeah.
Episode of Friends he did.
Yeah. So, obviously. But, yeah, that was pretty cool. So, as we walked by, I was like, man, you think he'll charge us to, you know, just talk to him? And I walked up.
Kiss him on the mouth and run away.
That's right. Grab his ass and haul ass. So, no, I was a big fan. We've talked about Space Camp in previous episodes and loved that movie when I was a kid, and he starred in it. And so I just walked over and I said, hey, and he's like, hi, and big smile on his face there. And I said, can you help me? I'm looking for a booth for this guy. His name is Hideo Takamine. And he just smiled and he said, it's pronounced Kevin Donaldson.
Hideo Takamine.
Right here.
Hideo Takamine?
Well, actually, it's pronounced Kevin Donaldson.
I don't have a Donaldson.
Well, I have one now.
I was just like, that's all I wanted. Thank you very much. Just that.
That'll be $18.
Yes. That's what I was afraid of. I got the hell out of there. So, pretty fun. Pretty cool.
Yeah, I splurged on a couple of the celebs. First thing in the morning, I walked past Peter Cullen, voice of Optimus Prime. Mm. And there were like 100 people in line. And we had heard our friend Russ had spent most of Saturday in that line. So I'm like, that might be an impossible get. I was okay with that. I could have survived without meeting him. But then, like, afternoon time, I walked by again, and there were only 12 or 15 people in there. So, like, all right, screw it. I'm going to do it. I'm going to meet him. So I got in line, and they have the taped-off snake. You know, you snake
through. It was weird.
Like the Brady room.
Right. To try and save room, but it just is weird. So the guy ahead of me didn't even know he was in line, I don't think. He was talking to the girl ahead of him. And she kept moving through the S, you know, snaking her way through. And he just kept, like, meandering around. And he had a couple kids with him who were not standing anywhere near the line. And he was asking questions. Who have you met? And who's this? And who's over there? And, oh, this is cool. And he gets to the front, and they ask him, like, what are you getting signed? He's like, oh, I don't have any cash on me. Can I just say hi? So he stood in line for like half an hour.
Man after my own
no
heart.
No plan. Yeah, it was weird.
And they were okay with it? They let him go?
And the lady.
No,
like,
he's still there. They've got him in his cell.
He was arrested immediately.
The lady was like, oh, that's fine. Just, you know, try to be brief. There's other people waiting. You know, just was too. And then, like, he asked if he wanted a selfie. So he took a picture with all the kids. Like, I don't think you're even allowed to take a picture of the celebrities. Yeah. But he took a picture with the kids. So I think it was just him being a nice guy. But I don't know what to say to these people. I struggle with this. I could plan ahead of time and script something, but it's not ever going to feel right. But so I just said, I'm sure you've heard it a million times, but you were a big part of my childhood. And he smiled and leaned back and goes, we had fun, didn't we? And I was like, that was awesome. That was amazing. That made my day. I loved it. Thank you, sir. I'm out of here.
Great. It is overwhelming when you get there. And I mean, you've, number one, all the people. I don't get out of the house much. I know I've said that before, but get there and there's all these people. And then I'm always frightened by, like, okay, if I'm going to go up to somebody and talk to them, am I going to get, like, you know, a side eye for talking to somebody and taking up too much time? I don't want to impose on any of the, plus you got all these people in line waiting to talk to that same very same person. So as you guys could tell, I just hung out with you guys as you went around to each creator and got stuff signed, and I wasn't going to get anything signed.
And
I wasn't
just
going to
side-eyed us the whole time.
I wasn't going to interact.
I feel like there's two kinds of people. There's that kind of person who worries and, you know, doesn't want to be in anybody's way or be a bother. And then there are the completely oblivious people who will stand in the middle of an aisle or talk to some celebrity or raise their hand in a Q&A and ask something you could easily Google.
Right, right. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
We had some fun, though. I mean, my goodness, we got to hit a panel. You guys got to talk to some people that have.
Oh, they had a great lineup there as far as, like, comic creators and stuff. Yeah.
Right, right. There was a lot of great creators there. I think my favorite moment was towards the end, walking through and just out of the blue, the girl from Mrs. Doubtfire is just waving at me. And I'm like, you know, you're doing one of these things. Like, there's somebody behind me. She knows. I know that much. And I look and there's nobody there. And she's just being real friendly and waving to everybody that's going past. And I was like, oh, that was very nice of her.
That was better than peeing next to Dan Didio.
I mean,
I had no idea.
That's a moment.
So, okay. So we're getting ready to get into the panel. Right. And first off, the bathroom situation was odd because I didn't understand, like, okay, there's the bathroom. All right, I'll head down that way and go to the left. And I see on the wall a what appears to be a man and a woman. And there's the woman's picture beside a woman's bathroom. I'm like, okay, there we go. And then there's the men's picture beside a woman on another bathroom, and it says
bring a friend.
Yeah, non-gendered, I think that was what it said. So it's like, so for the longest time I'm sitting there like, I can go there, right? I had to figure out, like,
Jesse's,
I'm certainly
like, I'm gendered, can I go in there? it's only for non-gendered.
So I'm Ken. I don't know whether I can go in there or not.
So I go, I walk back out, and I walk back over, and I try the door. Finally, I get the courage up to try the door, and I can't get in there. It's locked. I'm like, oh, okay. Well, I don't know where the other bathroom is. And then one of you boys was like, over there on the right.
Yeah. I was like, you're enough to go in there, but if you want to go over there, there's a men's bathroom.
There we go. Okay. Sure enough, walk over there. It's, as far as I know, empty. And lo and behold, I do my business. And as I'm standing there, this guy comes over and he's standing right beside me. We don't say a word. Of course, he ain't looking at each other.
What? You don't talk?
I don't talk. If I am talking to a creator,
you don't give him the side eye.
If I'm not going to talk to him at the table, I'm not going to talk to him in the restroom. But I didn't recognize him at first. I didn't recognize him at first, and I go wash my hands. I'm drying my hands. I'm like, man, he just something clicked. And I was like, he looks a little familiar. Come out of the bathroom, and then of course we go into the panels to sit down to listen to Jim Shooter and Dan DiDio talk. And here comes Dan DiDio. It's the man that pissed beside me in the bathroom, and I was like, oh my god,
how he was introduced.
Yeah,
it's like. Oh,
you might know him as the editor-in-chief of DC Comics or from the urinal right next to you. It's Dan DiDio.
That was great.
Yeah, that was pretty entertaining. We saw Jim Shooter. He told several of the same stories from the last panel we went to. We saw
really?
Yeah.
Oh, well, it was all good.
I love the one about the lady that stole my subscription.
Mm-hmm.
I knew I heard that story before. You guys must have told it.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah. No, good stuff. I was very excited that Dan Juergens was there. He was the main guy I was going to see and take books to have signed and
creator booster.
Yes. So that was definitely worth it for me just right there.
Sure. Well, what do we all get? I mean, I want to talk about at least my 11 issues of Kickers, Inc.
Okay, would you? Yeah, yeah. What an arc.
Oh, yes. No, I immediately, when we came in there, I'm like keeping my eye open for any comic books. I'm like, okay, I want to make a mental note of where these things are. And I don't see any. Can't find any for the longest time. And search and search and search and finally found a few booths that, some had, you know, long boxes of stuff that was like $5 and up. And then I finally found like the one spot that had 3 comics for $1. And they were just jam packed into these long boxes. And there was like at least, I don't know, 10, 15 long boxes. So I started rifling through them. And there were, like I said, some solid runs of some stuff that you probably aren't going to be. It's not very sought after. But 11 issues of Kickers, Inc. I said, I'll take it. And
there was Dan DiDio, right? The box next to me.
He was doing the same thing. It's like, don't I know you? And let's see, what else did I get there? I went around to some of the little shops, and I found a little sticker for a character that is on a show that we talk about on Radishes and Broccoli. Which is, it's not Hasbin Hotel, it's Hell of a Boss. So I just something small that I picked up there. And I think that was about it. I had picked up the keychain, the Out of Time keychain.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I dug that. Mm-hmm. And I found a bunch of little for the kids at home. I found some custom Lego figures. There were a ton of those.
Oh, yeah.
So got a bunch of those for kids. Cool. It was fun. I had a good time.
Yeah, I bought absolutely nothing. I kind of planned it that way because I.
You didn't even buy lunch.
Yeah.
A bottle of pop was $4, so that was that was my lunch. I need some caffeine. But they sent a survey.
Mm-hmm.
To my email, you know, from the same, you know, what did you think of this year? What can we do better next year? And I should have mentioned in the what can we do better was like the budgeting and the pricing online, like how few creators have their prices online, and several of them were wrong. So even people I had budgeted for, I got there and they were charging different amounts. So I had a budget that was pretty strict, and I kind of estimated what I thought people were going to be charging. And I was like, yeah, I'm not going to have any room for a back issue. So I didn't even go to that side of the hall.
Yeah.
Cliff, did you get anything?
I mean, besides signings, no, I don't think I did. I did walk and took the afternoon, part of the afternoon, walked a couple blocks down to Big Fun, and because I love that store, and I bought some cheap beaters, vintage Star Wars figures out of their $5 beater bin. It was super busy in there, though, and as usual, and had a backpack on. It was not easy to maneuver through that store as it was. So
easy criminy.
Yeah, but yeah, bought a few.
Put all their Ewoks back in the right order.
Yes, had to do some merchandising while I was there. Make sure everybody was up on their Ewok names and accessories and who went to what went to who, and yeah. And then I dipped out. Back to the con I went. So
I got a bunch of attention.
You were the belle of the ball.
You did. You really did.
You were turning heads left and right.
Oh, my gosh. So much envy. I can't wait for this year. That'd be great. Best decision I ever made, bought that Captain America shield. Meticulously picked out the version I wanted. Still comic booky, but kind of, you know, it's got a good color scheme and not one of the metal ones, light enough as plastic and stuff. And I went in there full size, right? You know, so a little big on me, but I rigged up. I could put it on my back and carry it on my shoulder. I could carry it, you know, traditionally. But I went around and got a bunch of creators to sign it. And man, put a couple autographs on that. People are like, oh my gosh, that's so awesome. Da, da, da. And they all want to take a picture and tell their wives they want that.
So see, how said, many people his, next year are going to be lugging this around?
Oh, just yeah. Bumping into each other. I made the mistake of posting it on a Captain America fan page. And I guarantee there's going to be 100 of me next year.
Yep. Yep.
But it looked amazing.
I agree. It's set in my
and
living room.
I was thinking, like, it's the perfect thing. Like,
it really is.
There's not much. I was thinking, like, okay, you know, if you're like a Thor fan, could you carry a hammer around and get it signed?
I mean, you could, yeah.
I mean, it would work, but it's just, it's not. Something about that shield is so perfect for that.
Yeah.
It's like maybe the Superman symbol would look nice, but then it's like, that's not an object.
Right.
Exactly.
Right. Yeah.
So, yeah, I think that's the perfect thing.
I guess what I was most surprised about it is how the majority of the creators were like actually acted honored to get to sign it.
Yeah.
Because they had to have worked on Cap. I tried to explain, you know, I was like, hey, you know, trying to get this signed, a lot of signatures, and please, however much you feel like you contributed, that's where you can sign on here.
You started play with a little mental game as well.
Started with DG Chichester. I was going to start with Steve Englehart, but he was doing an interview. So he was second. But went to DG Chichester. I was like, explained that. And he was the nicest guy in the whole place. And he was like, I'll sign way out here and really small. I was like, okay. And then I was like, hey, do you want to hold it up there and I'll take a picture with it? And I ended up getting everybody that signed it held the shield up and got their picture taken, and some of them were like, did some great poses. They took it very seriously and like held it up like they my favorite's Daryl Banks. I mean, it's a very comic booky the way he holds it, but someday I'll share all the pictures once I feel like I'm done with it. But Englehart, I had sign it right in the star, you know. I was like, you wherever you want to sign it, you know. And then but as I got going, you know, I told Jurgens, okay, you're getting the blue around the star, you had a nice, you know, 25 issue run here, volume 3, get in there, filled up that whole little blue section there. And I was like, Okay, getting a little frisky there. Go over to Brett Breedy, and I'm like, okay, you did. I probably shouldn't have fawned over him so much. I was like, you and Ron Friends did my favorite issue ever, Thor 390. Cap picks up the hammer, you know. So, but, you know, sign up how much contribution you did to Cap. He's like, man, Dan signed pretty big. That's what he says. I was like, yeah, he had a run on Cap. he goes, I mean, great. You have to keep in mind, these are the guys that did the death of Superman. You know, he's like, That's true. He did. And then he signed even bigger than Dan.
Yeah.
I'm like, okay. All right. I see what's going on here.
His is the biggest signature on there, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah.
Which I've wanted it for a while. Again, it's my favorite issue. I'll allow it. But
yeah.
I'm going to be super strict from here on out. Trust me.
Well, the nice thing about that shield, too, though, is if you were to absolutely get that, you know, the whole thing filled up, you can just flip it over and they can just start signing the backside.
That's true, yeah. Yeah, that'd be how insulting.
It's, you're on like, the back, buddy.
There's still some empty spots on the front, but I'm like, hey, great job inking that. But, oh, I love the way you lettered. Yeah, here, just get right here under the strap.
Right here on the inside lip, just like up at the top, please. Thank you.
But yeah, I really loved getting all the pictures of people holding it and being
that
excited to
adds to it.
Oh yeah,
especially
yeah.
for and, your memory and
yeah. I mean, austerity. Just a couple people were like, just the fact that they got to sign it was they were just like a few people didn't charge me their rate. They didn't charge me at all because they got to sign the shield. It was like, Ron Mars was like, oh, it's nothing. I did Marvel versus DC or whatever. That's what I was getting him for. He did a Cap annual. I was like, I think you should get on there. And he held that shield up so seriously. He's like, oh, I'm not charged. I'm just excited to be on it. You know, I was like, that's awesome. You know,
yeah.
So I'm hyped. That's my new project.
These guys are fans, and they're also little kids. When you play with a toy shield, you're gonna grit your teeth and do it.
Yeah, yeah. It was awesome. It's like just to see a lot of. I'm such a fan of these guys. I don't care about these celebrities, but I love these comic creators. And just to hear their stories and stuff. I like to tell them something particular I liked about their comics, you know, thing, you know, especially if it's something Cap, something that, you know, connected with me. And like, I mean, even the first DG Chichester, he's like, I only did the Cap and Punisher 3-issue miniseries, Blood and Gory. I'm like, yeah, but I love the, you know, at the end when, you know, Captain America salutes Captain, you know, Castle, you know, at the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. He's like, I know. He's like, a lot of people hated that, but you know, I'm glad you get it, you know. And I was like, yeah. Or Ann Nesenti, who was so cool. She did a Daredevil issue with Cap in it, and her issues were very politically charged, and she put that into Steve Rogers in that issue. And I was talking to her about it. I was like, you got to be on here, because I felt like he said things he didn't always get to say. And, you know, and she was way into it, you know, just like excited about it. And I was like, I have such a good time. Tony Isabella, you know, wrote in the 100s of Cap, and I brought him one of those record comic combos.
Yes.
You know, from back in the day. And he's just a little dude, but he held that shield up and it covered almost his entire body. But I was like, he held it seriously, and he's got his protect trans kids shirt on or whatever. I was like, these guys are still heroic and, you know, to me. And I'm excited about the whole endeavor.
Yeah. Yeah.
Similar thing with the posters I've been working on.
Oh, those are turning out cool, yeah.
Yeah, my Batman poster I took for Jim Lee to get signed that last show, and then I've got a Daredevil poster, because there were so many Daredevil creators. I thought, oh, there's a perfect thing. And these are a pain. They're a pain to carry. They're getting wrinkled.
I dropped them.
The signatures are wet when you get signed, so you got to carry it around like half unrolled.
Right.
I've already got scotch tape on the Daredevil poster because it started to rip.
Yeah.
It's a huge headache. And then I got them home and put them in a frame, and my God, I love them. They are gorgeous.
They do look good in that frame.
And I'm just getting started, so hopefully I can fit like, you know, just like your shield. You want it completely full to the brim. So, yeah, it's cool. It's people who did work you respect and work you enjoyed And you get to share a little moment with them and let them know that. Like, because comic books are so, they're such a distance. You know, you sit at home and type your script out and you send it away to get drawn. And then it goes out to an audience that might tweet at you or something. But yeah, that's why I've always loved going to these conventions, to put a face on these people and just have that personal moment that you so rarely get.
Yeah.
Pretty awesome.
Yeah, I just had a great day. I mean, I had so much fun from the time we left till we got back. I mean, it was just a good time with you guys and you know, lots of jokes and whenever had some good food, got some pizza afterwards and
late night slice, it's tradition now. We gotta get the we went over and ate at the North Market for lunch, and then
boy, that place was something else.
Got everything in the world. What'd you end up finding? All the food around the world. What'd you get, Jesse?
I asked Mindy. I sent Mindy a message that said, "Do I go with the turkey melt or do I go with the goat? Because I have no idea."
Always go with the goat.
Yeah.
I had no idea what to do. I walked in that place, then I walked around again, ran into Cliff, I think. I'm still trying to figure out what in the world I need to eat.
I felt bad because, like, you know, we've been there before. Basically knew, I think we both of us probably knew what we were going for.
Yeah.
And like we walk in and we're like, here we are, Jesse. And just Seth goes one way. So I go another
way.
I was like,
if we stick close to Jesse, he's just going to watch me get food.
Yeah.
I was like, I got to let him go find his own food.
I did eventually. That sandwich though was good, man. Was it good? Got a sandwich and fries and a Coke and it was delicious. Yeah. Like I said, never been there before. I love the way that it's set up so you could go upstairs and sit and eat and watch all the stuff happening down below, which was really cool. Loved that. And yeah, the late night slice.
That's good pizza.
Goodness. Pack away three slices. I'm watching you guys. I'm like, man, I'm missing out on something here. I only ate one, but those slices are huge.
Yeah, they are. Yeah.
Man, I tried they to. Were good.
I that was my whole deal was I was supposed to, you know, I knew we were going there and I was supposed to bring home a whole pizza to my wife and daughter.
Oh yeah.
And of course I got up there and they're like, we're not selling whole pies. We're running out of dough. And I was just like, it's like three people in here. I'm like, okay. And then I tried to buy a bottle of their garlic dipping sauce. And she's like, oh, we're out of that too. So I came home empty handed and let me tell you,
you should have just stayed in Columbus.
That did not go over well with my daughter. I walked in and the look of disappointment, because she basically met me at the door expecting that pizza.
Wow.
And I walked in and she just looked and put her head down and turned around and walked back to her room. And I mean, it was like, I just murdered her best friend. I mean, she was not happy for a while. And I was like, it's not my fault. I tried.
look, pizza and nerds. That place got besieged. The place was besieged by nerds. That's what nerds eat. They eat pizza all the time, hot, cold, whatever. So you're lucky we got to eat.
True.
Yeah.
True story. All right.
The list of the people we met, so a couple, we'll name drop a couple more people. Simon Bisley.
Oh.
He was cool. I meant to take more pictures of people.
Mm-hmm.
I only took a couple of like people who holding up something that I got signed or whatever. I just keep forgotten. So he was one of the first people we met. I was like, oh, can I get a photo while you're signing? He's like, sure. And like he turned his glasses all sideways and crossed his eyes and stuck out his tongue, like, because he's kind of a wild man artist back in the 90s. And I got the picture and laughed, like, oh, thanks. He's like, oh, don't you want to do a serious one? Like, dead serious. Like, he's like, oh, that was just the fun one. He's like, don't, it's like, he wanted to do a whole series. I was like, I don't care, whatever you want to do, sir. I said, DG Chichester, class act, Dennis Cowan, cool guy. Who else? Jenny Frison, does a ton of variant covers, just gorgeous photorealistic art. Greg Horn, who I'd met before, but I wanted him on the Daredevil poster because he did a run of Elektra and some some issues of Daredevil. He had a variety of autographs. Like he had the premier signature. He would just sign it for one amount.
You even gave him a new term, and I already forgot it. What was it? Like he had three different levels of signature.
Yeah, he had the regular.
Yeah. You said, yeah. He said, I have this Greg Horn. This is, and then I have the extra, and then the super awesome. And you're like, I'll just take the Greg Hill.
Dan Jurgens, that was cool. He's been toward the top of my list for people I've wanted to meet for a long time. Scott Collins, Ron Mars, and Ascenti was a sweetheart. I forget what we were talking about. Because I gave her the old issue of Daredevil and then a more recent issue of Elektra. She's like, oh, a new one. I love when you have new ones. Cause like she's sick of signing old stuff, so she likes that people are still reading her stuff.
Right.
So we talked for a minute, and she's like, she signed the poster. And she's like, oh, are you going to get, because Charlie Cox and Vincent D'Onofrio over there, oh, are you going to get the people from the TV show to sign this? I was like, no, I don't think so. I just prefer the comic people. She's like, oh, okay, great. And so she tried to somebody had given her a print, like those motivational posters, like the black frame with the white lettering underneath it. So someone had done a Daredevil one that said devotion or something. Mm. She's like, this won't fit in my luggage. It's like, do you want this? I was like, no, I'm good. I got enough stuff to carry in this bag. I can't. But so that was really sweet.
Yeah. It's a real dick move not to take her present.
Well, yeah.
That poster holder will only hold so many.
Yeah, I can't.
That could have been like the hidden thing behind the poster.
It's like she was re-gifting it. Someone gave it to her. She's like, I don't want this.
That's not a super fan.
I'm guessing an artist there in Artist Alley who sells those was so proud of it. Okay. Like, I'm giving it to a creator. She's like, I don't want it. But a sweetheart.
Imagine if that guy saw that one custom poster that was, and he's, wait a no,
what? Carried it around.
Yeah.
Yannick Paquette, who did a run on Swamp Thing that I adore. It was the new 52 Swamp Thing. I loved it. He's done a bunch of Batman. He was really nice. I had an issue with Wonder Woman he did that I had had. I think Adam Hughes did the cover. I had signed, and Bob McLeod printed it or inked it. I had his signature. He's like, oh, you've got almost everybody. And he was talking about the writer. I don't know what he's up to now. Like, he was trying to help me track down, where can you meet the writer? He wanted to help me get the book completed.
Yeah, he was a super cool guy. I had brought, apparently, the correct issue of, he did a cover for Mr. Miracle, and I get a 10-minute story about the color green and how that particular color was impossible. It was impossible green to print that color. And I got the whole story.
They did it. Somehow.
I was like, there it is.
I saw that issue.
There it is.
Look at it. It's printed.
So
pretty green.
Dan Parent, who's done Archie comics for about the last 30 years. I've seen him at a couple shows, but I've never really had anything to get signed. But I saw he was doing remarks for a decent price. And I looked at my spinner rack at the store, and I had an issue of Sabrina, where she was on the cover. She's watching Riverdale. And on the TV screen has a Riverdale logo. So I'm like, I got to get this. So I got a little, he sketched a little Jughead head for me. So I got some Archie original art I'm real happy with. Yeah, ton more people, but yeah, just a fun time. Oh, I did. I get a few more on my Batman the Animated Series poster that we've talked about on here. Shook Ron Perlman's hand, who was Clayface on that show, but Clayface is not on the poster. So I said, there's no Clayface on here, but he's like, where do you want it? Is this good? Sure, wherever you want to sign, Ron Perlman. And Tara Strong, who again had a very long line. She voiced Batgirl on there, but she was Miss Minutes in the current Loki series. She was a Powerpuff Girl. She was a My Little Pony. She's voiced a million people. lots of fans. She was really sweet. She like unrolled the poster and was looking at it. She's like, oh, this is so cool. You met this person and this person. And Jeffrey Combs, famed for Reanimator, the movie. He was the Scarecrow.
Frighteners, right?
Right, yeah.
Yeah, okay, all right. Just making sure. So,
added three more to that poster. Three more living folks that I've tracked down.
They're all doomed.
We'll get
now.
Mark Singer. We'll get Mark Singer one of these days. That's the only one left. Mark Hamill and Mark Singer. I'm coming for you.
This is Jordan's death note. Yeah, everyone that signs it gets to live longer. Like they're just like, thank God I thought you'd never bring this here so I could live. We did it. Lo, what's it's Christmas.
Yes, it is. And we don't feel like doing anything else but reveling in the Christmas spirit. What was it last year we did the family feud?
Yes.
Sort of game.
Sort of, yes. Yes. It was. I forget. Yes.
So.
Christmas family feud or something. Yes. The candy cane shaped cookies and cookies shaped like candy canes or something like that.
So that was fun. So I was trying to find something like that again, and I was Googling and looking around. And there's a lot of games that were like you couldn't do on a podcast, like charades and things like that. And then there were trivia games, but some of the questions were ridiculous. So I came up sort of those would you rather questions. So I'm going to give you some holiday themed would you rather?
We're
going to
F, Mary, kill.
No, we're either oring.
The reindeer.
We're either oring.
Oh, okay.
And I saw there were some that were like, would you fight a hundred elf sized reindeers or one reindeer sized elf? Like those kind of, we're not doing that. We're going to try to keep it in the, we do the yeah, you know me segment. Where you get to know us. So we're going to try to keep it that way. Does that make sense?
Sure. Yeah.
I'm all in.
All right. So they should be short. They could just go quick. Whatever, however you want to. Yes, no. If you want to expand, tell an anecdote. Go crazy. So I broke them down into segments. So we'll just do like clockwise. And then we'll switch who goes first every segment.
Okay.
So you don't have to, they pretend to have to go every.
I don't know that all our screens look the same.
Yeah. Okay.
Just cue me up.
You let us know.
Why wouldn't they look the same? I don't understand that at all.
Oh no! What are you doing?
They're already moving.
Oh. Now they all look the same. I think. I think I just changed it.
Oh okay.
Cliff, are you in the top right corner?
Yes.
Okay, we'll start with you then.
Ooh, pressure.
So this is yeah, you know, ho ho ho, me.
I've known some ho ho ho's.
You know ho ho.
This is yeah, you know, ho
ho ho, ho, ho pimp. I'm kidding.
Refill your eggnog for you.
All right, so either or, Cliff, real tree or fake tree?
Oh, fake tree. Always.
Jesse. Yeah, absolutely a fake tree.
Yeah, fake.
Yeah, I grew up real and insisted on real, but it's fake. Fake is fine.
Fakes all the way.
Fake you. Yeah. All right, Cliff, colorful Christmas lights or solid white?
Oh, colorful.
Absolutely. I definitely will change it up just about every Christmas. And this year I'm going with straight white lights.
I just do a white tree with white lights because of paint scheme in there. I like colored lights. I like seeing colored lights, but it just doesn't match my place.
My Christmas decorating is always.
If I want to see that kind of stuff, I just look a couple houses down.
Yeah,
just freaking all kinds of
gaudy and It looks like Christmas threw up all over our house.
Looks like hills. Hills over there.
That's where the toys were.
Yeah,
I think the white can be classy, but I think I prefer the color. All right. Matching Christmas pajamas or ugly Christmas sweaters?
Oof. I don't really have a preference here. Matching pajamas, or I would say probably, I don't know. I've never done really much either. Ugly Christmas sweater, I guess. I don't know. Sure.
I can imagine your whole family having the matching.
We've never done that. Never done it.
Yeah, I think we tried the matching pajamas once, and ugly Christmas sweater is, I mean, there's so much hilarity in that. I'll take it.
Yeah. I earlier this year, I bought a sweatshirt from Death Knight. It's of a Death Knight. It's from Death Saves, a D&D brand Joe Manganiello runs or whatever. But it's a Death Knight Christmas sweatshirt with, like, he's all got colored Christmas lights on him. So I guess that's the sweater answer.
I like some comfy PJs. I like the house pants. I like spending the whole day not changing out of the house pants. My mom always had, before ugly Christmas sweater as a term became a thing, that's only been in the last decade or so, like, she always had, we called them her garish Christmas sweaters. That just became the term. Garish. Like, all moms that are garish Christmas sweaters. Before ugly Christmas sweaters, we always had the garish Christmas sweaters. All right. Preference, white elephant gift exchange or secret Santa gift exchange?
Secret Santa.
Okay. White elephant is the one where, like, everybody trades.
Yeah.
Right? Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. You pick a number and you can steal. That kind of
thing. That is the way that we go every time at this house. So
it's the white elephant.
Yeah.
I've got some horror stories with that. So I go to the same Christmas party every year and they do that, and I've won it multiple years and I just dread it because you get a bunch of drunk people mad that you got the liquor.
Oh yeah.
And it's like, how about just, I'm ready to switch it up for secrecy.
My favorite year of doing that, because we did that at work, when we were in office, year in and year out, but I purposely bought something that I wanted and made sure that at the end of the white elephant, somehow I was the one that ended up with what I got.
I always try to take something really, like, I want the thing I bring to not be the punishment. Because there's always something crappy in there somebody brought.
Yeah.
I'll bring some
Yeah.
Yeah. I'll bring some expensive liquor. And twice I left with my liquor because I pulled the last pick. Not everybody likes that when you do that.
we did the white elephant for a stretch of years with the extended family, and someone always brought lotto tickets. And everyone fought over who got the lotto tickets. Yeah. No one ever won a dime, but you had to get the lotto tickets. I never quite understood that.
I was trying to, I think it was last year, I tried to get people in the right frame of mind. Like somebody else brought liquor and, somebody picks it early. They get this stuff. I'm like, you own this right now. Drink it. Open it. Start drinking.
Yeah.
It's like, a party. Yes, if somebody wants to take that at the end, take a half a bottle of liquor at the end back, that's fine. You still got, you had it you for got, a while.
You got enough, yeah.
All right, hot chocolate or eggnog?
Oh
gosh.
Hot chocolate.
I'm curious to see what you guys say.
Yeah, definitely hot chocolate.
I was just telling the wife tonight, I said, you know what you needed to put on the grocery list? Eggnog.
Oh my god!
I will drink. Man, Mindy would get sometimes like the half gallons of eggnog, and
I can't even imagine drinking something. Like, I've never had it. It sounds horrible to me. Meanwhile, Jesse's like, I'll take the home fries. How about your eggs? Nog.
Please.
Yeah.
Ugh. I love
it. It sounds horrible.
It is. Well,
it just sounds gross. There's just something about it. Sounds, I don't even know what it is, but
yeah,
eggnog.
Eggnog, the word is, yeah. Right.
I'd rather okay. Rocky it. I'd rather put a raw egg in a glass and drink it than drink something that I don't know what it is.
Cliff, have you had eggnog before?
I have, yeah.
Okay, all right. Yeah. So
hot chocolate's good. It's chocolate, it's hot.
Yeah. That's right.
It's not nogged egg.
It's okay. Not snot. All I hear, I just see and hear snot.
Well,
come on.
We, back when everybody used to come to our house on Christmas Day, I remember several years Alicia did like a hot chocolate bar for all the kids. And
yeah, that sounds good. Put a little crushed up candy cane on there, maybe this or that. I don't trust anybody's version of eggnog anyway. Like I don't want some homemade eggnog. I don't get your whatever I'm going to get from that.
No, I mean, I get it. People like it and, you know, people put liquor in it and stuff. And,
Yeah.
Like my wife likes it okay. She kind of grew up with, you know, their family. That was something their family had or whatever, yeah. But yeah,
sounds too rich or something rich sounded about it. It's like it's a little too. I don't know what it tastes like. It's all in my head.
I don't want to get liquored up.
I have never had it.
No
I've
idea.
Never held a cup of it. I've never smelled it. No. But I don't.
Yeah.
I don't.
No idea.
To.
But
good.
It's all the things I'm thinking. For sure.
I never wanted to get liquored up on it, and then like that stuff come back up. You know, in reverse.
And you know it would.
No, you know it would.
Your threshold's way lower if. That's how you're drinking your liquor. It's just like, next question
be,
before I throw
I didn't
up.
Expect this to be the most controversial. We're just getting started. We're already at each other's throat. Yes, hot chocolate 1,000% for me. All right, cookies or candy?
Mm. Ooh. Mm. I'm third every time, so I'll just wait.
Cookies.
Cookies. Definitely goes good with these eggnog.
Cookies. No, man, you dip them in your hot chocolate. Hot chocolate.
That was a big thing for me growing up. Both of my grandmothers, I can remember helping make, you know, like hardtack candy, a homemade. And,
oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That, like when I think of Christmas candy, that's pretty much what I think of. You know, candy cane, stuff like that. Yeah, sure. But that's the main thing I remember. But yeah, overall, it's probably cookies.
Yeah, man. We're talking like chocolate chip, sugar cookies.
Yeah.
No bake cookies. I mean, just.
Yeah. My ex-sister-in-law makes a bunch of different kind of Christmas cookies every year. And sometimes they send them over here. But it's like, just like, they're all good.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
Yeah. Yeah, I love the candy, but I feel like you can get candy anytime. Candy's always available.
Yeah.
But those like Christmas sugar cookies, that's a Christmas thing.
And I associate Miracle. Candy more with like Halloween.
Okay. Yeah.
So.
Ham or turkey?
Ham.
Yeah, ham for sure.
Yeah, I'm probably turkey now.
What do you mean now?
I imagine it depends where you eat it, who's making it, mm-hmm. or whatever.
Okay.
But for a while, we used to get the spiral hams with that are like sweet and you know, falling apart. If it's that's what I want. But I'm sure I haven't seen any of those show up in a few years. So so I'd rather have the turkey.
You're in luck. This is entirely imaginary.
Yeah. Oh well. I really like turkey. So.
You one of those
a little gravy on there.
What was the ham that Claire or was it Claire had to have in the oh my goodness Christmas with the Cranks.
Yeah. The heavenly ham.
Was it heavenly ham? Honey baked ham? Something heavenly honey baked or something like that? Yeah. Yeah. And then it gets run over by a semi.
I'm on the ham train. All right. Peppermint or cinnamon?
He's going ham for ham.
Oh.
Peppermint.
I'm answering first. Peppermint.
So, say it again. Peppermint,
peppermint or cinnamon?
Peppermint. Peppermint or cinnamon?
Yeah. Yeah, definitely peppermint.
Peppermint hot chocolate is the secret. That's, you put a little peppermint in your hot chocolate, that's the jam.
You ever had that peppermint ice cream?
I don't think so.
I know. I've had candy. I've handed some.
Falling all over himself.
Oh, I love it. It's tasty. Yeah, I've had some candy cane ice cream. And then mom used to buy the peppermint ice cream. It was good. Good stuff.
Yeah,
I'm peppermint. I like the smell of cinnamon, but I like the smell better than the taste.
Yeah.
All right, that was the first section. So now we're into the second section. So we'll start with Jesse on these.
Oh, my gosh.
A Christmas Carol or Twas the Night Before Christmas?
Christmas Carol. And correct, make sure that I'm right here. This is the one that Scrooge is based off of?
Right.
Yep, there you go.
So, yeah, right. Scrooge and Tiny Tim or... Wondering what do my wondering eyes do appear in the reindeer and all that stuff.
Yeah.
I like the Ronald P. Tramp Twas the Night Before Christmas.
That's a good answer.
That's like part of the reason I'm leaning to. I like the simplicity of the poem. You know, Christmas Carol's been adapted into a million different versions.
And I don't necessarily love any of them. I'm not even a big fan of the Muppet one.
I'll go ahead and just kind of say that, you know, probably what gives it the edge is the time travel.
Yeah.
The sci-fi story.
Shotgun.
Yeah, I'm going to say Twas the Night Before Christmas. I like that.
It
gives a tradition, you know, Christmas Eve, reading the poem to the kids. Like, that's cool.
Yeah, I absolutely love Mickey's Christmas Carol. The special I watched as a kid that I think came out with Fox and the Hound in the very early 80s, with Scrooge and Donald and Mickey, and you know, I love that, but as my initial reaction is probably the poem Twas the Night Before Christmas, as far as like, hey, if there was something we're gonna tell a story or read on Christmas Eve, that would be more the go-to. So, I guess
you're not going to break out the Dickens novel.
No,
chapter one.
Yeah,
but we might. But we're probably going to play that 30-minute Disney special, though.
What a coincidence! The next one: Mickey's Christmas Carol or Muppet's Christmas Carol? Jesse,
I'll go with
Mickey or the Muppets.
Yeah, I'm going to go with the Muppets there.
I normally would always pick Muppets over Mickey, but I feel like the last time I watched it, I was like, what? This is the hype? This is what the hype's about? Everybody freaking go crazy about Muppet Christmas Carol, and I don't remember really liking it that much. So I don't remember the Mickey ones. I'm gonna go Mickey.
I gotta go Muppets. It's been ages since I've seen either of them, but I stick with the Muppets.
Don't get any big hurry.
Yeah, definitely Mickey's. We've already watched it multiple times this Christmas, so.
Well, that's just weird. Okay, y'all.
How the Grinch Stole Christmas or Charlie Brown Christmas?
We covered this, didn't we? A few years ago.
Well, in a different format.
That was a different time.
Different podcast.
We might have evolved. Who knows?
I will go with How the Grinch Stole Christmas.
I don't remember what I picked, but I know. I feel like Grinch got eliminated too early in that, but
I think we pitted Grinch against Rudolph.
Yeah,
if I remember correctly, because I still have a bone to pick.
Yeah, I think I don't know. I feel like I would have picked Grinch. Yeah, I think I'm Peanuts.
I feel like Charlie Brown is the more classic answer, but I watch Grinch every year, but I don't watch Charlie Brown every year, so I guess I gotta say Grinch.
Yeah, I like them both pretty even.
Yeah, honestly. I like them both. Today it's probably Peanuts. When I was a kid, it would have been the Grinch. So.
Oh yeah.
As a child, I thought, as childs think, I like the Grinch.
Then you I have got to hold the blanket up when you did that.
Frosty the Snowman or Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer?
Well, that's a good one. I'm going to go with Frosty the Snowman.
Happy birthday.
I'm quite a fan of snow.
Are we talking the song or the cartoon or what are we talking about?
Oh, yeah.
Or just, as cartoon. A character.
Christmas special.
Okay.
we're talking movies and TV in this section.
Yeah, I'm probably going to still stick with Frosty the Snowman. The one thing that I always traumatized me after watching that is him melting. And I was, then again, I might be getting something confused with a later version or something like that.
I think it was in the greenhouse.
Yeah.
Okay.
The little girl Karen in there. She had to take her in there so she'd get warm.
That's right.
So spoilers sad. For freaking Frosty the Snowman.
he came to life one day. So, but yeah, I mean, that's what I'll go with. Frosty the Snowman.
I still probably have to get Rudolph. Like, in there, Spark. Get right out. What's the Donner's a real prick?
Yeah, he is. He's terrible.
Son of mine. Yeah, Rudolph, 100%.
Love them both. Probably more nostalgic for Rudolph. Probably. I don't know. I feel like, I don't know. Yeah, Rudolph, sure.
Elf or Home Alone?
Oh, man, that is a tough one. That is actually really tough for me. Gosh. Both of those are standard watching at this house when Christmas rolls around. And there's very few movies that I will go back and revisit. Christmas time clearly is a reason to revisit some of these shows. But I'm just personal favorite. I'm going with Home Alone. For the family, they would go Elf. I know for sure. But I'm going to have to go with Home Alone because I was just going, Harry! Harry, a couple days ago, to see if I could remember what I was doing, but Home Alone.
I think if you polled the public, 75% to maybe 80 would be Elf, but I'm Home Alone.
I haven't watched Home Alone since the 90s, I don't think.
Really?
So it just doesn't have
that
nostalgia for me. And I really liked Elf when it came. Like, it's one of the few modern Christmas movies like that I can rewatch and it's
stand up on your seat.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I'm gonna stand up and say Elf.
Some do. Elf, yeah. Love it.
Die Hard or Gremlins?
These are great questions. Wow. Okay, so I've just got I'm going Gremlins. Gremlins is...
There are no stakes to this, Jesse.
Yeah. I know.
You can't be wrong.
I'm sitting there thinking,
who am I?
I just don't want your blood pressure to skyrocket.
Who am I letting down? No, I'm definitely going with the Gremlins here. I love Die Hard. It's a great movie. It's just a ton of action. There's always the argument, is it a Christmas movie? I don't step into any of that. Gremlins is definitely a Christmas movie. I got so many memories of watching that thing as a youngster, you know, with my dad watching that. And my dad was always a sucker for action Christmas movies if he could find one. And that's kind of what sticks out to me. Such great violence that happens in that movie too. The gremlin getting stuck in the microwave. Those gremlins, they go through it. All right, I'm stepping back. I'm done.
Yeah, I have no nostalgia for the gremlins or whatever. It's Die Hard for me, top 100 movie.
Putting this list together, I probably would have, you know, Die Hard's the obvious answer, but then I started thinking, it's like, no, I love Gremlins so much.
Yeah, that's cool.
And if it's the holidays, like, yes, I'm on the side of Die Hard is a Christmas movie, but I don't necessarily watch it at Christmas. But Gremlins, I could definitely, I think Gremlins edges it out as a Christmas movie for me. So I'm gonna go Gremlins.
Yeah, I don't hate that. I don't remember what year Gremlins came out, but it was pretty early 80s, and one of those. Yeah, one of those movies that I don't know what it was. Was it PG, I think? And like crazy, I was that young watching that thing blow up in that microwave. But yeah,
go ahead. I want to say it was, I think, responsible for that. And what was the other one? Was it Raiders? Or it wasn't one of them responsible? No, it was, oh my goodness, what's the second one called?
Oh, that created like PG-13?
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Temple of Doom.
Thank you very much. Yeah, so I think that had a hand in it for sure, because it is over the top for a PG movie, that's for sure.
Yeah, I don't know. Ho, 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 now I have a machine gun. It's pretty, pretty Christmassy.
Scrooged or Ernest Saves Christmas?
Oh. Easy for me. I do love Ernest Saves Christmas, but Scrooged is absolutely one of my favorite movies that I watch every Christmas. Christmas Eve. I mean, as for me, it is on Christmas Eve that Scrooge has to be watched.
I remember seeing Ernest Saves Christmas in the theater out there that's now a tool store. Has been for years.
Oh, yeah. It has
been for years. That's right.
I that is the public opinion.
Yeah. I remember, what was my other choice?
Scrooged or Ernest Saves Christmas?
Yeah, Scrooge. I pick Scrooge. Yeah, definitely.
I like Scrooge.
That's the why. What that should have been the Christmas Carol version. over Muppets or
yeah, pit those two against each other.
Yeah, Bill Murray's great, but I'm leaning Ernest. I've always loved that movie. It's smart, dumb humor. It's fun. It's family friendly. Ernest P. Worrell.
Yeah, that movie was filmed at Disney's MGM. Studios in around Orlando in the Kissimmee area. Just recently, they tore Ernest's house down. It was just in the neighborhood there, around there. And but anyways, yeah, I would vote for Ernest.
All right, and the top seeds: Christmas Story, Christmas Vacation.
Christmas Vacation, pretty. I know that my wife really hates A Christmas Story. it's so much that she saw it so much because her brother loved it. He passed a few years back, and now it's like something that it's on, which you just can't escape it. You're going to run into it somehow. Now in the days of streaming, you can avoid it if you want to. You're not tied to TBS and maybe accidentally coming across it. But yeah, Christmas Vacation has, to me, some of the more funny moments, and Chevy Chase always cracks me up. So there you go, Chevy Chase.
Oh, and it's so not close for me. Like, we said recently, I think Christmas Story is overrated. Not Christmas Vacation is a classic, and as much nostalgic people that we are, like that movie about nostalgia, you know, him setting up, you know, she has to literally drop him out of the nostalgia of the attic, you know. Yeah. I love that movie.
I was just before we got on here, I was just watching some stuff with my wife 30 years ago, Christmas. So let me start over, because this won't make sense if I start here. I digitized a bunch of home videos, and I also put them on my computer.
Trying to help out some AI program, I'm sure.
Yeah, put them all on there so everybody knows what it
was
like.
Where he takes his camcorder, puts it in front of the television.
That's brilliant. So I digitized all these, put them on there. So essentially, you remember we did the WTAP thing when we were doing the role playing game. So it's all on the computer now. we were sitting upstairs. I've got a way to watch like all these whole movies. And that's exactly what we were doing, was upstairs watching Christmas from 30 years ago, 1993. Me and the wife were actually 1 year dating at that point. So it was neat because we could sit there and watch ourselves, you know, 30 years ago. But yeah, I get that nostalgic feel that Clark was going through.
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, I go vacation for sure.
Both movies probably in my top 10, but Vacation is my all-time favorite movie, period.
I knew that would be too hard of a choice for you.
Yeah. Love them both, but yeah. We have, Carly and I have watched A Christmas Story Christmas that came out last year. And, man, I tell you, it's going to be a classic in our house. Like, and we've watched it several times this year alone. And I swear to God, by the time we get to the end of that movie, we're both in tears. Mm. No matter how many times we watch it, like, it is really good. And she swears up and down it's better than the than the original. So.
All right, that brings us to section three, in the music section.
Oh, boy.
So this will start with Seth. Blue Christmas or White Christmas? Elvis or Bing?
White is right.
Oh. Well, I say Blue Christmas.
I can only hear the freaking Porky Pig version, so I just I hate, and which I don't like, so I like White Christmas.
White.
Yeah, White Christmas.
Right, Santa Baby by Eartha Kitt, or Baby It's Cold Outside by Dean Martin.
Those are my only choices. Dean Martin.
Babies. Those are the babies.
Dean Martin.
Yeah, it's canceled.
Mm-hmm. Right. Oh,
but,
yeah.
But Santa Baby should have been canceled a long time ago because it's terrible.
Yeah. Cliff?
The second one.
Wow.
Can't even say it?
Baby is cold out.
Yeah.
It's a good song. I'll go with Santa Baby. I like Eartha Kitt's version. I love her voice. She was just playing on Spotify a couple weeks ago.
Like, I like all of these songs. Like, they're all on my playlist. So for Christmas, so I don't know what to say.
Yeah, I don't like that song.
John and Yoko with "Happy Christmas, War Is Over." Paul McCartney, "Wonderful Christmas Time." Beetle Battle.
Beetle Bailey.
I don't like either.
Yeah, how's the first one go?
It's the with the kids sing in the background. They sing the chorus. War
something
is
about
over.
Christmas Day.
Oh, well, there we go. Okay, now I know what you're talking about.
Yeah.
That was beautiful. So I definitely. I'll take that one, I guess.
I'll take that specific version, actually.
Yeah.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah, I hate that song.
Yeah, I don't like either one.
Paul McCartney's is the worst song.
Yeah, I don't like
not
that.
Not even Christmas song. It's the
worst song. There's one worse. It's that Bruce Springsteen song.
Oh, you know what? Christmas time. Yeah.
I hate that.
That's not many.
That's not many.
I hate it. So bad.
Yeah, John and Yoko, I would take over that terrible McCartney.
I don't even know if I'll go with Paul McCartney.
Sorry, everyone. That was my fault.
Okay.
For bringing it down. We were on a high. Now I'm proud of it. All right. Jingle Bell Rock or Rocking Around the Christmas Tree?
rocking around the Christmas tree.
I don't know. They're both pretty good.
I like them both.
I think we play Jingle Bell Rock in the every year in the concert band.
Oh, it's a band story. I knew it was going to be a band story.
So I think I'll go with Jingle Bell Rock because I could probably still play the drum part.
I like them both. I'll say Jingle Bell Rock.
Rocking around the Christmas tree.
That's tough.
Right now, I don't know where these came from, but...
Oh, here we go.
Nat King Cole or Michael Bublé?
I'll take Nat King Cole.
Bublé has a beautiful voice.
Yeah.
He's a modern maestro.
Yes, sir.
He's a knockoff Harry Connick Jr.
Yeah, I'm gonna go Bublé. I think that kid's got.
Oh, he's got some. Got kid.
The grandma.
he's gonna go somewhere. I know it.
I would say Nat King Cole.
I'll go Bublé.
Johnny Mathis or Mariah Carey?
Could you maybe sing a couple bars of Johnny Mathis for me?
He had a bunch of them, didn't he?
He's
all the standards.
Mathis, Johnny Mathis. I don't dislike a couple things Mariah Carey does, but I don't want to hear that Christmas song.
I don't get what the hate for that. I think that's a banger.
It's just played all the time.
It's just played so much.
Yeah, I've met the. I've met my quota on how many times I need to hear that in my life. Yeah.
Five years ago. Like it's become a meme almost. It's Christmas, release Mariah Carey, that kind of thing. But it's a good song. She deserves it.
During COVID, I think it was maybe in New York, there was, you know, everything was still kind of, you know, bad. And I had seen, I think it was on the news or something. There were just people in the streets and it started playing the Mariah Carey song. And like, people were just having the best time ever, you know, young people. And I was like, yeah, that's kind of, you know, that is the new Christmas anthem for sure. But I would take Johnny Mathis as a whole,
Mariah Carey.
All right. Pentatonix or Trans-Siberian Orchestra?
What's the Pentatonix do?
They are like the a cappella group.
Newer in the last, decade.
Trans-Siberian
or so.
Orchestra.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of it. It's clever what they do without the instruments and the... you know, they're very talented, but it's not for me. I'll do the Dwight Schrute.
It's like the vocal blue man
Siberian
group.
Orchestra. Yeah.
Just not talented enough, I'm afraid.
Maybe they should paint themselves up or something.
Yeah. Trans Siberian
Orchestra. Trans protect Trans Siberian Orchestra.
Right. Protect them at all costs.
Right. Same here. Trans Siberian Orchestra.
Finally, Alvin and the Chipmunks or Emmett Otter's Jug Band.
Look at the birds up in the trees. We're not birds, we're jug band.
Probably Alvin the Chipmunks.
Is Emmett Otter streaming on Disney?
I don't know. I haven't seen it forever.
Asking you.
I know, but I'm trying to think. Like, I wouldn't even be able to vote for it because I can't remember a song or anything.
Oh yeah. I don't know if it's on Disney. It is on something. I've ran across it already. It's definitely
one I feel like rewatching.
I would highly recommend it. Like, if you haven't seen it since you were a kid, it's pretty great.
Yeah, just based on memory, I would go with Emmett Otter because I watched a lot of Alvin and the Chipmunks as a kid, but that song grates pretty quickly.
Yeah, I I have very vivid memories of being, like, when we lived on Montgomery Street in Marietta, and I think we moved when I was six. But we had HBO, and every Christmas I watched Emmett Otter's Jug Band Christmas when it would come on, and as often as I could. It's definitely Jug Band Christmas.
I never watched it. I've never seen it.
Came out in 77, I think.
Was it?
Yeah.
Okay. I've heard so many people talk about it, but I've never had the chance to sit down and watch it all. So, but I did own the Alvin and the Chipmunks tape, cassette tape, the song on it that you're talking about. So I'm going to have to go with Alvin. Alvin!
Okay.
Those are pretty good.
All right. On the part four, these are just kind of the odds and ends to close out. So I guess I'm answering first on these ones. Travel during the holidays or stay home? I just want to stay home. I don't want to go anywhere. I don't even want to go to other people's houses.
Nobody is going to say travel. I can't imagine anyone saying I.
You guys don't go to skiing or go to the coast or anything.
Yeah, it's stay home.
I have a rich cousin that goes to like the Bahamas or something every Christmas.
Yeah, we have a friend that goes on a cruise. Their family goes on a cruise like the week of Christmas every year.
We ain't a Bahamas podcast.
No, I was like, I go to the Bahamas in January or something. This is the one Christmas is the one time it's cool to be cold.
Yeah, I think if I could stay in my basement, I'd
he doesn't want to travel upstairs.
No. I don't want to... He's not.
That's the truth. One of the greatest Christmases I think that I've had was the. What was it like 3 or 4 years ago when it snowed and like snowed like 6 inches outside? And it was the most beautiful thing, most beautiful Christmas I'd ever seen. Nobody was going anywhere. Nobody was coming over to my house. I wasn't going anywhere.
That's where we got to the way you said that. That sounded like the most important part.
Exactly. I wasn't going anywhere. We were going to stay at the house. We were going
play
to
play with our toys,
open up the window and look outside and don't do anything other than just hang out. And that was probably a perfect Christmas for me. So yes, absolutely, I'm going nowhere.
Yeah, so you are an expert segwayer, because the next question is, do you want snow during the holiday season or no snow at all? I think it's pretty, but I never want snow, so I don't need it to. I do not need it to snow on Christmas. I'm good.
Yeah, I pretty much agree. I think it's great to look out the window and see it, but living where we live, up on this giant hill, I would just assume never have to deal with it again.
Yeah, you're never going to get me on tape asking for snow. Yeah. I'm going to hold that. I'm not going to use that against me in some ritual.
Yeah, I'm such a fan.
I like the look of it. I if it's here, great. You know, I'll enjoy it looking out the window, but I'll cuss it when I know I got to go. Yeah.
When you got to drive in
the driveway.
Right. Yeah, do something in it. Yeah. No, I 100% want it to snow. It just bothers me right now.
Spoken by a guy that works from home.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, it bothers me right now. We're in December and it's not snowing. That just, you know, it grinds my gears. I don't like that. So, but yeah, I would want it to snow like 3 feet on Christmas if it could.
Would you prefer to sleep in on Christmas Day or get up early?
Would I prefer?
Like, pretend you have a choice.
Right. Right.
I can sleep in. That's fine.
I am a 100% get up early. It's the only day of the year that I would choose that. But yeah. always get up early.
We still joke. My aunt came in one year. She lived about 2 hours north of here, and she came in Christmas morning, opened the front door, was like, "Ho ho, what the hell?" Everyone was still asleep. Like, she got there like 8 a.m. and we were all still asleep.
I remember that was always a big thing. Once we had kids, we made a very early decision when Cooper was probably one or two that it's no fun dragging all those toys and gifts around on Christmas Day. So we were just like, we're staying home. Anybody is welcome at our house all day long. I don't care what time. If you want to come over, feel free. We would love to have you. We're staying home. We're not going anywhere. We have kids. That's the way it's going to be. That's just the rule we came up with. What was the question?
Get up early.
Sleep in and get up early. One year, I don't know. The kids weren't very old, and my kids always got up. You know, we would go to the late mass, come home. There were years we were still wrapping gifts half the night and, you know, doing that whole thing. It would be like 3 a.m. before we went to bed, and the kids were up. They'd start getting up at like 4 coming in. And because we didn't go anywhere and everybody came to our house, it made for a long ass day.
Yeah, it did.
But I remember one year we got up and it was like, I don't know, like 5 or 6 a.m. in the morning. And my grandparents, who were probably like 80 years old, were sitting in my driveway in their car waiting on us to get up.
Oh, man. Because
they didn't want to miss anything with the kids. And I was just like, holy cow. I thought, you know, we were obsessive about it and getting up early and all this crap. But, yeah.
Make sure the deadbolts are thrown on Christmas Eve. Nobody's getting in here.
Yeah, I was upset because I was like, once I figured out they were out there, I was like, what are you doing? Like, knock on the door. Like, come in. Knock on the door or something. Don't sit out here in your car and wait for us to get up.
Sitting on the stoop. They didn't even get in the car. They're just out there shivering.
Yeah.
Man, I would prefer to sleep in. That's for sure. I'd love to sleep in if I could. I just know it's not going to happen. It hasn't happened for 18 years. So it'd be nice, but
not in the cards. Not in the cards.
Now, yeah. Do I hate getting up early? No, I don't. I mean, it's fine. I'll get up early. You get everything out of the way. 9 o'clock rolls around. You start getting all the trash gathered up, and then, you know, maybe you can catch a nap later.
Oh, that Christmas nap is so
Christmas
out.
Nap. That's right.
Yeah, I work midnight, so I'm usually up at night. So those morning hours are the when I get the most sleep in my life. So I'm a wake up when we wake up for Christmas.
All right. Would you rather know what all your gifts are going to be, or do you like to be surprised? I want to be surprised. I don't care if it's I don't like making lists. I don't like telling people what to get me. I don't care if the present's not even very good. I would rather be surprised and know exactly what I'm getting.
Yeah. Surprised.
I don't want to know what I got, but, you know, I definitely make lists. I'll tell you that much. I'll be like, hey, this would be good. This would be nice. But I would hate to go into Christmas and go and know exactly what I was getting. That would suck. So I'm going to go with surprise.
Yeah, I want to get things I want, but I also would the ultimate in gift getting or giving is to give someone something that they want that they didn't even know existed.
Right, mm-hmm. Right.
That's the
best.
Goal. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I try to, you know, People have gotten Christmas gifts from me before that I don't even normally buy them a gift just because I found something that I know they would really like that they probably don't know exists. I'm like, well, you're getting a gift this year. Guess what?
Yeah, I definitely grew up with a mother and her mom were both like, tell me what you want, write it down, pick it out. You know, here's the Sears catalog, the JCPenney catalog, the Montgomery Ward, you know, that type of thing. And that's probably why I'm like, yeah, sure, I want, you know, I definitely have a side of me that I'm like, well, I know what I want, but I would prefer, you know, not to know.
Yeah.
It's much more fun.
All right, so if you don't hit that peak threshold, do you return or do you re-gift? I don't do a lot of returns. So if I can re-gift it to somebody, I will definitely do that. I don't feel any shame in re-gifting something. That's not a dirty word to me.
But you're not about to take Ann Nesenti's fucking poster.
Yeah.
I was going to say something, but I was like, ah.
She's a re-gifter.
Yep.
I don't know. I don't really, I guess return. I don't really have an answer. I'm not a big re-gifter, so.
Yeah. I mean, the opportunity doesn't present itself very, it has to be a perfect thing to get something that you think you could get away giving to somebody else.
And yeah,
I'd much rather return and get some cashola or something I want. So
yeah, there's a whole strategy in regards to, or risk you're taking if you want to re-gift that thing. You better re-gift it to somebody that lives at least 30 miles away and you do not see them in town, or you hope they will not be in town very often. But the thing is that I'm kind of like there with Jordan. I don't, you know, I'm not going to go stand in line and return something. That's just the way that ain't happening with me. So I would probably leave.
Not with all that snow out there.
Yeah.
Expect me to go to the post office and wait in a line or something? I don't know. Regift. I will regift.
All right. We're running toward the end here. So I have a couple weird ones. A holiday robbery scenario. Would you rather have backup?
Yes, Rob.
From Kevin McAllister or John McClane?
Okay.
If I was being robbed, who do I want defending my home, basically?
Right. So you're in the likely scenario, there's a Christmas robbery going on. And you there's can make a one, you so can make one like, phone call.
Is there a
to an 8-year-old sort of office
Christmas party? I was left home alone at an office Christmas party.
That's what I'm getting at.
I'm
brainstorming a screenplay right now.
Oh, man.
I think Kevin's a little crazy for me. I think John McClane would, like, he knows law. Like, he knows you can't, like,
he knows
torture
law.
People with hot iron and stuff. Like, he'll kill you. He won't laugh.
Yeah, that's the train of thought I was having. I'm like, well, you could, you know, severely maimed or dead. What do you want for these people? And dead doesn't feel very Christmassy, so.
Oh, boy.
Yeah.
I mean, if I'm picking here, I'm going John McClane.
Got Punisher's banner hanging behind him. He's a hardcore murder. Kill them all.
Got one of them there on my truck, too.
Yeah. I'm going Kevin.
Yeah.
Could order pizzas after. That'd be cool. All right. Would you rather tour Santa's workshop or party one night with Krampus? Personally, I couldn't keep up with Krampus, so I'm going to go see how the magic happens at Santa's.
Yeah.
Party one night with Krampus.
Yeah. F, Mary Kill, I'm going to marry Mrs. Claus.
Krampus.
I'm going to F Frosty the Snowman.
Marry the narwhal.
Is that something? Is the narwhal Christmassy?
He's an elf, Mr. Narwhal.
Narwhal is an elf. I didn't know.
He was in Elf. Remember?
I don't remember. No. I thought the narwhal was like some weird creature.
With a horn.
Isn't that a thing? Yeah.
Listen, I thought it was a myth up until about a couple years ago. I continually got made fun of. So I'm not even jumping in on this one.
I don't know. I just know the name. It's something. It's like Krampus to me. I don't give a shit what it is. I don't fucking care.
Krampus came to the Mid-Ohio Valley, didn't he? And then like everybody was in an uproar.
Really?
Krampus was. Oh. Yeah, believe it or not. You guys remember
Christmas,
that, right?
Yeah, one of those Christmas parades that had Krampus as the float. It scared the children. Oh. We brought a demon to Marietta.
God. Is Krampus the same as Belschnickel?
What the heck is that?
Belschnickel? Yeah.
That sounds more up my alley.
Are you
German? That sounds like a pastry. Yeah. I would eat a Belschnickel every once in a while.
Wash it down with some eggnog.
Oh,
it's a Belschnickel, dip it in your eggnog. It just comes up just completely covered. Doesn't even drip. It's just like thick ass.
The glass eggnog. Is empty. The glass is empty when you bring it out.
One big snot rocket of eggnog hanging off your Belschnickel.
Oh, man.
I'd Belschnickel Frosty the Snowman.
I'm partying with Krampus. I'm just throwing this out here, so I don't want to. Partying with Krampus.
Have you been impish or admirable?
Right, exactly. I don't know. I guess I would probably choose Santa's workshop. I'm from the Mid-Ohio Valley, and I would be scared
of the Krampus.
Belschnickel.
You would need like a fast pass. Like you would need to plan out your trip to the workshop.
Oh, definitely.
Make sure you hit all the right, you know,
bathrooms.
Oh, oh man.
I want to know about their payphones.
Like, why are all these commodes so tiny? They're right for elves.
Yes, absolutely.
All right. Would you rather spend Festivus with the Costanzas or Life Day on Kashyyyk with the Wookiees?
Oh, man.
Come on.
My immediate thought is, of course, I want to go to Kashyyyk, but it's so weird. There's so much.
I don't want to get freaking. I know somebody's going to give me drugs. I'm going to end up watching Jefferson Starship on the freaking Kashyyyk screen, and
we're all going to get busted by the Empire. It's going to go on our permanent records.
Mainlining something with Norton.
Mm-hmm.
I think hanging with Kramer would be fun, but I would go to Kashyyyk. I would have to try.
Well, I didn't know Kramer was going to be at festivals.
Oh, yeah. You can hang out with all the...
I was just the Costanzas. That's... I don't know if I want to be there for that.
Mm-mm. No, it's a lot of yelling. Life Day.
It's a lot of Wookiee wailing going on up there on Life Day, too. I can't tell whether they're mad or they're celebrating Life Day.
It's interesting that this comes down to what the volume of the other participants.
Yeah, I just want to chill out, relax on the holiday. I don't need.
I don't need all this and all that stuff going on.
Yeah, yeah. Are you guys like excited about your concert you're watching, or the stormtroopers here? I can't figure out what I'm supposed to be happy or sad.
Well,
I know I'm supposed to be mad at the Costanzas. At least I know how I'm supposed to act.
Got a lot of problems with you people.
Nah, it's Life Day. Come on.
I'll go Festivus.
Yeah, Festivus for me.
All right. I don't know if this is comedic or thoughtful, but would you rather have a visit from the ghost of Christmas past or The Ghost of Christmas Future? That's tough, because I'm sure there's good Christmases I'd want to look back on and relive. I'm not sure I want to know what lies in store. That would worry me a little bit.
It never works out good when The Ghost of Christmas Future shows right. up.
There's probably yeah. a reason he wants to show me something.
Yeah.
Yeah. This is your last chance before yeah. this.
Yeah.
Look back and enjoy. Oh, yeah. Enjoy
that seems something. Like a seems like a easy peasy answer.
Mm. Not risk. Just let the dice fall where they may. We'll risk the future later.
Yeah.
I'm going Christmas past.
Yeah, Christmas past is where it's at.
Yep.
I guess I'll go Christmas future here then, because I'm going to be the one guy who wants to create a paradox to try to figure out how I'm going to change things.
Just call yourself.
Yeah. Yes.
Have you help yourself out.
Yeah. Fuck the physics, yeah. Santa.
A little bit of time travel ain't hurt nobody.
All right. Last question. Peace on earth or goodwill to men?
Oh.
I'm a peace on earth. Let's get peace on earth.
I
you can't have goodwill to men and you have to suffer fools then. I don't do it.
Yeah. I want to think if you have goodwill to everyone, that'll create peace, but I don't.
Right.
I think that just gets you walked over. I don't know. Yeah. So, yeah, let's hope for peace on earth.
Peace on earth.
Sounds good to me. Peace on earth.
All right. There we go.
Oh, my gosh.
That's Christmas, everybody.
That's Christmas.
This is Christmas.
Oh, I'd rather go to freaking...
For rich or for poor.
Costanzas.
Whether you're traveling to the Bahamas or you're snowed in Jesse's basement, we hope you enjoy your holiday season. We hope you got to know us a little bit better, these holiday questions.
Does that put a wrap on 2023 for us?
Yeah. Yes.
This will be our final episode of 2023.
How about that? Wow.
What number of episode is this going to be?
398.
Oh, it's so close.
Oh, man. Right on the cusp.
About there.
So come back in the new year. We're going to do our annual movie preview where we scout out what's going to be hitting theaters all through next year.
That's the next episode after
the next thing
is complete movie preview of the whole year.
Six movies.
It's a weird year. There's probably not as much coming out as previous years, but
I'm just as much fun seeing how effed up the past year was compared. I like to go back. I've already downloaded it. I want to listen to that episode to us talking about all the movies that were going to come out this year and how stupid we were. Probably.
Yeah. Arby.
So. And then after that, it's number 400. Look back into the past at a fun clip show time. So we're going to take a little bit of a break, a little bit of a breather, stretch things out a little bit, but we'll be back before you know it. Jesse, where will you be before people know it?
Oh, my goodness. Well, I'm always over there on the Source Material Comics feed. You should be able to find that on any podcatcher out there. We're on Spotify, Spreaker, Overcast. There it is. You should be able to find us out there. Subscribe. Listen to us talk about comics. The Source Material Comics podcast about comic books of any era. Usually that's me and Mark recently talking about we're going to have Not All Robots on the schedule here pretty soon. So you can hear us talk about AI and how it's coming for our jobs and Mark Russell's satirical look at things. Then on the Unspoken Issues podcast, if this airs before or after, it's going to be right around that area of Christmas time, I'm sure. You should be able to hear myself, Evan Bevins, Chris Armstrong, Dean, Derry. We all get together. We're talking some Marvel holiday specials. We talk about the Sleepwalker holiday special. It's a lot of fun there. You can check that out. And then, of course, Evan Bevins and myself get together and talk about Marvel Snap, which is a mobile card game that you can play. Lots of fun. Check that those episodes are actually going to be dropping. They're in the process of dropping right now, where we're talking about the most current season, which is the Hellfire Gala. And last season, Higher, Further, Faster. And you cannot miss Evan Bevan's top five Marvel Snap cards that best represent Taylor Swift lyrics. That's right. You can find it right there on the Marvel Snap. No, let's try that again. The Snap Material Podcast. That's all I've got. Thanks for having me on here, guys. It was a lot of fun.
Well, again, thanks for coming with us to Columbus.
Yes.
Fun time. Thanks for jumping in whenever we have a spot here to do fun stuff like this. We really appreciate it. And we will see all you in the new year. Happy holidays, everybody. My name is Jordan Lope.
Cliff Barnes.
Jesus Christ.
I'm Seth. Bye, Frank.
Ka-Pow, the Pop Cultured Podcast, is intended for entertainment and information purposes only. Sounds, music, and clips played during the podcast are property of copyright holders. All original content is property of www.udamwithkpp.com. If you enjoyed this podcast, please subscribe and leave a comment. Ka-Pow, the Pop Cultured Podcast, can be found on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Podbean, Spotify, and wherever podcasts can be found. You can connect with us through social media on Facebook, YouTube, at the Ka-Pow Podcast on Twitter, or email the show, Ka-Pow, the Pop Cultured Podcast, at gmail.com. If you really want to go the extra mile, join our Patreon at patreon.com/udamwithkpp for special content and access to Patreon-only benefits. We are grateful for anyone who chooses to contribute, but please know that most of our content will remain free. So please continue to like, comment, and share.
If I was listening to this, I'd definitely freaking put it on triple speed. Like... there's a lot of thinking.
I thought he had a mouthful of eggnog. He couldn't swallow it.
Couldn't choke it down.
It's good for you. It's tasty. A little bit of nutmeg. Yeah, put a little nutmeg in your eggnog.
Oh, yeah. That sounds like they go together.
Oh,
somebody
man.
Nutted my eggnog. Oh,
God.